Recorded Books and One Click Digital present Airborne, The Combat Story of Ed Shames of Easy Company by Ian Gardner. Narrated by PJ Ochlan. Dedication. I would like to dedicate this book to the following soldiers: Paul Rogers, Amos Taylor, Roderick Stroll, Forrest Guth, and Joseph Madonna. These soldiers made me the soldier I became. Edward D. Shames. God Almighty. In a few short hours, we will be in battle with the enemy. We do not join battle afraid. We do not ask favors or indulgence, but ask that, if you will, use us as your instrument for the right and an aid in returning peace to the world. We do not know or seek what our fate will be. We only ask this: that if die we must, that we die as men would die, without complaining, without pleading, and safe in the feeling that we have done our best for what we thought was right. O Lord, protect our loved ones and be near us in the fire ahead, and with us now as we each pray to you. Colonel Wolverton's prayer on the eve of 3rd Battalion's insertion into Normandy. 5th June, 1944. Foreword. From 1996 until 2005, I served as founder and president of the World War II Veterans Committee, and from 2005 until the present, I have been president of its successor organization, the American Veterans Center. Our mission throughout all these years has been to recognize and honor our veterans' legacy of service and sacrifice, and to preserve their stories for future generations. In the course of my work, I have been privileged to meet and get to know hundreds of veterans, from Frank Buckles, the last American veteran of World War I, to newly returned servicemen and women from Afghanistan. Among all these individuals, Colonel Ed Shames occupies a special place. He is, to use an overwrought phrase, a true American hero. A member of the legendary E Company, 506th Regiment of the 101st Airborne Division, now known globally as the Band of Brothers, in World War II, Colonel Shames was the first member of this storied division to receive a battlefield commission after D-Day. The arc of his amazing life is traced in this book, which follows Shames from the quiet streets of Virginia Beach, Virginia, to the new airborne training camp at Dachau, Georgia. From rigorous training at bases in England to the historic D-Day landings of June 1944. From nearly continuous battles, including Operation Market Garden in Holland, to the heroic defense of Bastogne in Belgium. From heavy fighting through Germany, to a visit to Hitler's Eagle's Nest retreat in Bavaria, where Shames helped himself to a monogrammed bottle of the Führer's cognac. A bottle that was opened on a deliciously ironic, wildly improbable, and triumphantly fitting occasion, the celebration of his son's bar mitzvah 17 years later. Along the way, we read of Colonel Shames's encounter with Martin Bormann, detention of Feldmarschall Albert Kesselring, and a gut-wrenching tour of Dachau. He was one of the first American officers to visit that horrific hellhole, and the visit still haunts him 7 decades later. We also meet many memorable characters along the way, including Colonel Robert Sink, portrayed memorably in Band of Brothers by actor Dale Dye, and Ida, Colonel Shames's wife of 70 years, a lovely, vivacious, and spunky lady who is a fully worthy match for her tart-tongued husband every step of the way. When Eddie returned home in 45, Ida told me, the real war began. Ed Shames remains amazingly strong and vibrant at the age of 92, and his memories of the war are remarkably vivid and detailed, and all ably related in this book by author Ian Gardner, who supplies rich context and historical detail. I have spent many, many enjoyable hours chatting with Colonel Shames and listening with rapt attention to his personal accounts of World War II. He is a master storyteller, and I have lamented to him many times what a shame it was that a larger audience could not hear his story. I rejoice to say that with the publication of Airborne, his story has been told at long last. It is a valuable addition to the historical record as we mark the 70th anniversary of the end of World War II. James C. Roberts, President, American Veterans Center, Great Falls, Virginia. Introduction. As a former British airborne reservist, I have always been interested in the history of the sky soldiers from World War II, especially the American 101st Airborne Division. My first book about 3rd Battalion, 506th Parachute Infantry Regiment in Normandy, Tonight We Die as Men, was co-written with Roger Day and published by Osprey in April 2009. I am in no doubt that my limited military background was one of the reasons why over 50 3rd Battalion veterans put their trust in me. Trust is an easy word to use, but despite my obvious connection, I feel it still had to be earned, which is why Tonight We Die as Men took almost 6 years to research and piece together. Roger was already well established as a semi-professional historical writer, and it was his skill and patience that helped shape the book into what I believe is a first-class piece of nonfiction literature. Unlike many of our peers, we were not professors of history or university lecturers. Although in theory this should have held us back, and maybe in some ways it did, it quickly became apparent, at least to me, that having no official academic qualifications was sometimes of benefit when it came to dealing with the old boys. Most felt that my casual, open approach and sense of humor helped them relax without feeling intimidated or self-conscious. As my contributor list grew by word of mouth, I spent hundreds of hours on the telephone getting to know my guys and their families, all the while learning more and more about their individual experiences on D-Day and beyond. Almost like method acting, it became easier for me to contextualize the huge amount of information being passed to me. Luckily, I found a family in Saint-Côme-du-Mont, a close-knit village in Normandy near to where much of the 506th action took place, who were willing to take me under their wing. Subsequently, I spent a lot of time in-country with Michel Léonard, occasionally even accompanied by some of the veterans, talking with locals who, we must not forget, were also caught up in the fighting, following up leads, finding new ones, but always reporting back after each trip to discuss any details with each relevant contributor. Since Tonight We Die as Men was published, I have followed the exact same research process to produce two further highly detailed volumes, Deliver Us from Darkness and No Victory in Valhalla, charting the story of 3506 through Holland and Bastogne to the very end of World War II. Roger armed me with the tools to approach both of these projects without any further editorial assistance, and I am now pleased to be taken more seriously as a historian and writer on my own merits. This combat biography, Airborne, was specifically written about Ed Shames because of his undeniable contribution to 2nd and 3rd Battalions. Ed featured throughout my previous works, but this book goes a long way toward filling in the gaps, providing the reader with a better understanding of what he, as a volunteer, put himself through over 70 years ago. I first met Ed in 2002. We had spent months speaking on the phone, but this was the first time we had met in person. We spent 3 days pondering over maps, working on the Battle of Bloody Gully, which took place near Carentan. At that point, I had not figured out the exact location, but with a little help from Ed, moved closer to understanding what had happened on June 13, 1944. It wasn't all business, and every day we made time for a decent lunch, washed down with a couple of beers at my local pub, the Prince of Wales. A few years later, as we became more familiar, he told me, "Aw, come on, Ian, who's gonna believe all this crap?" Maybe he was right, but Ed's service in World War II has many twists, and I always knew that if set into a well-researched narrative, Shames's story could be appreciated by many, not just those interested in E Company or Band of Brothers. Due to the success of Stephen E. Ambrose's book, Band of Brothers, and the subsequent HBO miniseries, it is sometimes easy to forget that Ed spent almost 2 years in 3rd Battalion, mostly as Lieutenant Colonel Robert Wolverton's Operations Sergeant, S3. This book not only puts a little more flesh on Ed's previous service, but also explores the roller coaster ride he experienced after he was reassigned to E Company. Ed's character, as portrayed by Joseph May in the HBO miniseries, was a mouthy individual with a mean attitude, which is not the person that I have come to know. Ed would be the first to admit that back in the day he could be a real SOB, but always insists that he was fair with it. That there are inaccuracies in Band of Brothers is widely accepted, but perhaps in my opinion, the most important inaccuracy is the way Stephen Ambrose described the attack to recapture Foix on January 13, 1945. What really took place, and the reasons why, were, in my opinion, completely misrepresented regarding the participation of the other units involved. The composite version of E Company created by the miniseries troubled some of the veterans, including Earl McClung, Darrell Shifty Powers, Robert Popeye Wynn, James Moe Alley, and Rod Stroll, who were all fiercely proud of 3rd Platoon, which Ed took command of in mid-October 1944. In addition, several other integral members, such as Amos Buck Taylor, Paul Rogers, and Forrest Guth, were never really included by Ambrose or HBO. In May 2013, Ed came over from Virginia, probably for the last time, on a final tour across Europe with me, where we revisited many of the sites identified in my previous research and a few new ones. As a result of hours of conversation and work with Ed, and over a decade of research into the 506th during World War II, Ed's personal recollections have now been set against a factually accurate backdrop that we hope will engage any reader interested in this period, both emotionally and educationally. Despite the close relationship that I now have with Ed, I have done my best to avoid bias and use all the information at my disposal to make this project as accurate as possible. Ultimately, this is his story, warts and all. My hope is that Airborne provides a glimpse into one man's incredible life experience, a life which has not been without controversial moments. This is the unvarnished truth of a very young man fighting and surviving a war, and his actions should be set into context rather than be criticized from our own more comfortable position in the 21st century. Airborne deals with the loss of friends and reveals in no uncertain terms that freedom is most definitely not free. Hopefully, Ed's war story has something for everyone. Sit back and enjoy the ride. Ian Gardner, August 2014. 1. Take the A Train. December 7, 1941. The rich vibe of Duke Ellington and his orchestra was suddenly interrupted as a sketchy news flash filtered across the early afternoon airwaves. Shocked by the unfolding bulletin, Ed Shames and his friends Elmer Trant and Melvin Dawley moved closer to the radio. On Sunday, when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, Elmer, Melvin, and I were sharing a room at the Laurentian Hotel in Hamilton, Ontario. The preemptive assault conducted by Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto was intended to keep the U.S. Pacific Fleet from impacting on forthcoming Japanese combat operations in Southeast Asia against British, Dutch, and U.S. forces on the Philippines. The Japanese airstrike sank several important ships and caused nearly 3,700 casualties. The following day, President Franklin D. Roosevelt proclaimed December 7, 1941, as a date which will live in infamy, and the U.S. National Congress proceeded to declare war against Japan. A few months before the attack, we were happy-go-lucky 19-year-olds studying to become naval engineers at the Steam Engineering School in Norfolk, Virginia. Politically aware and determined to do our bit in the war, we were still too young for the peacetime American military. However, The minimum age for the Royal Canadian Air Force was 18, and as they were recruiting potential officer cadets to train as fighter pilots, we decided to give it a go. Melvin's father was a very successful businessman, and we borrowed his car to drive up to Hamilton for our assessments. Before leaving Norfolk, we made a pledge to each other that it would be all or none. Over the next 5 days, the Canadians put us through a series of aptitude tests and stringent medicals. At the end of the week, we were shocked when Elmer was rejected after being diagnosed with a heart murmur. However, Melvin and I were accepted and given 10 days to sign the enlistment papers. Elmer wanted us to go ahead, but we had a deal, and that was all there was to it. We went back to the Laurentian Hotel and decided to spend the weekend out on the town. Of course, December 7th was the day that everything changed, and after the Japanese strike, we packed our things and returned to Virginia. Ed Shames' war was about to begin. Edward David Shames was born on June 13, 1922, in Virginia Beach, Virginia. I was the youngest and preceded by sisters Anna and Simmy and brother George, aged 2, 6, and 8 respectively at the time of Ed's birth. My father David had studied engineering and fought as an infantryman in World War I. Dad was smart and in the early years worked hard to build up a small portfolio of properties and with my mother Sadie established Shames Provisions, a rural country store situated along Virginia Beach Boulevard. In 1927, Dad died suddenly from pneumonia. He was only 42. Assisted by her youngest brother, Ben, Mom took over and successfully kept the store going. During the Great Depression, things went from bad to worse, forcing Mom to sell off Dad's properties at a ridiculously reduced price. Thankfully, we lived in the flat above the store. I attended the Henry Clay Elementary School, and much of my spare time was spent helping out in the store. One of the pupils, Clifford Irby, was 2 years older and not only bullied me, but many other younger kids. One morning while walking to school, I picked up a length of lead pipe. During break, Irby cornered me in the toilets, and I hit him with a metal cosh and split his head wide open. Afterwards, we became great friends. But I think the incident showed me that aggression could be channeled and controlled if and when necessary. By the time I turned 11, I had a job selling magazines and saved enough to purchase a small rowing boat to go fishing in Chesapeake Bay. My dad left a pair of Smith & Wesson pistols that I'd use regularly to shoot targets in the local woods. Of course, my mother knew nothing about it. When, as a teenager, I began to get interested in hiking, my mom gave me a set of local maps and a compass for my birthday, which kickstarted my lifelong fascination for topography. Mother always made sure that we had food and even sometimes wine on the table and decent clothes to wear. When my brother George asked if he could attend the Virginia Polytechnic Institute Military School, despite the costs involved, Mom agreed without hesitation. The price of uniform, trunk, and school fees was well over $100, and I remember she paid with gold coins that my dad had left. It was then she told me about the golden rule. He who has the gold rules. I've never forgotten it. George graduated in the 1930s and decided to pursue a career as an engineering officer in the Navy. Eventually, he was posted to run the main refrigeration plant at Norfolk Naval Base and never went overseas. Following the attack on Pearl Harbor, it was only a matter of time before Ed would join his brother in uniform, and he was determined to be at the sharp end of the war. 4 or 5 months after returning from Canada, Ed read in a national magazine that the Army Operations Center, AOC, at Fort Monroe, had announced the creation of a specialist volunteer parachute unit. After Pearl Harbor, the Japanese had successfully invaded the Philippines, and American fortitude appeared to be rapidly declining. Senior members of the War Department's civil service had the unprecedented idea of creating a super unit recruited directly from the civilian population. The civil servants realized the public relations value of such a regiment especially one drawn from the general public, rather than the regular army. It was correctly assumed that the principle of civilian volunteers would raise the country's morale. As Monroe was only a few miles away, I went over to their recruiting office seeking further information. The 506th Parachute Infantry Regiment was looking for volunteers, and only the best and brightest people need apply. Plus, a qualified parachutist would earn an extra $50 a month. After reading through the glossy brochures, I decided to put my name down as a potential recruit. The minimum age was 21, but as I still had 11 months to go, written permission was needed from my mother, who initially wasn't keen to sign, although eventually, after much cajoling from me, she agreed. By late August 1942, Shames received his joining instructions and was ordered to attend the U.S. Army Reception Center at Camp Lee, Petersburg, Virginia. Camp Lee was about 75 miles from Norfolk, and there were hundreds of kids from Virginia, Maryland, and North Carolina. After being processed, I was put on a troop train with Charles Cartwright, an ex-fireman who lived in Norfolk on Marshall Avenue. The regular service ran from New York to New Orleans and was packed with young men, all scheduled for different stops along the way. Our destination was a small town in northeast Georgia named Tocoa, and when Cartwright noted it was 6 a.m., we knew we didn't have much further to go. No more than a whistle stop, the station had seen more activity in the last 4 weeks than the previous 10 years. Tocoa would be home for Shames, Cartwright, and other 506th hopefuls for the forthcoming months. Getting off the train, I heard a door slam behind me, and this dark-haired guy with large ears walked over and introduced himself. "I'm George Rattan. How are you doing?" Up until that moment, we hadn't realized that there was anyone else on our train bound for Tocoa. 4 years older than me, George, who was from Syracuse, seemed very self-confident and sharp. We shook hands and were still laughing as a sergeant strutted over and instructed us to follow him to a waiting truck. Camp Tocoa was 5 miles outside town, nestling beneath the powerful shadow of Currahee Mountain. After passing through the front gate and turning right, the vehicle followed the road to an enormous grass parade ground. In the corner closest to the camp was a collection of tents known as W Company. Due to recent heavy rainfall, the ground was a sea of thick red mud. Rattan, Cartwright, and Shames were allocated temporary bed spaces. After a cold, damp night, reveille was something to behold as dozens of shivering figures, some still wrapped in blankets, tried to carefully negotiate their way through the ankle-deep slush for roll call. Because of the mud, we soon learned that W Company also had another title, Cow Company. After our names had been checked, we underwent a thorough medical examination. A history of broken bones was enough to cause exclusion, as was color blindness or poor eyesight. Mental ability was also considered important, and to pass, we had to have a qualifying score equal to or surpassing that for Officer Candidate School, OCS. I was passed A1 fit and given service number 13117836 and the lowly rank of private. As for Rattan, when they found out he'd attended one of the best private preparatory schools in the States, Fork Union Military Academy, he was immediately promoted to acting sergeant. One of the guys in my tent, Joe Madonna, had come in the day before. Maybe because of the intense overcrowding, Madonna managed to rub me up the wrong way. Joe was a short, stocky, Italian-American from Winthrop, Massachusetts. So not only a damn Yankee, but also an eye tie. And there's me, a Jew Southerner. During the thankfully short stay in Cow Company, Shames and the others were issued their basic equipment and clothing. The following morning, one of the regular Army cadre NCOs introduced Ed and his new friends to the mountain. The feature marked the western edge of the Blue Ridge Range, and over the next 13 weeks would come to symbolize the 506th PIR. The cadre were, for the most part, from the 82nd Airborne, and temporarily attached as platoon sergeants or squad leaders. It was their job to teach us civilians every aspect of military life, including physical training, PT. Ed's group stood in formation on the parade ground as it was addressed by one of the instructors. "Gentlemen, today we are going to put your fitness to the test. You see that lump of rock? It's called Kurahi, Native American for stands alone. The beast is 1,753 feet high, and the summit trail approximately 3 miles long. Any of you who do not make the 6 mile round trip within 1 hour and 10 minutes will fail and be immediately reassigned to a non-airborne outfit. Do you understand me?" Shames looked across at Rattan as the squad replied as one, "Yes, Staff Sergeant." Wearing coveralls and brand new ankle boots, the men doubled past a long row of buildings belonging to regimental headquarters toward the start line. Initially, it did not seem that difficult, but as the 20-foot-wide dirt road began to snake its way upwards, the pace increased, and Ed's legs started to burn. At that point, some people were already dropping back. About 10 minutes later, as the track approached a rocky outcrop close to the peak, it became much steeper and turned sharply before zigzagging to a wooden lookout tower on the summit. Without taking a moment to catch his breath, Shames touched the triangulation point and was on his way back down. Legs and feet pulsing in pain, he was now struggling to keep up, and much to Ed's surprise, Madonna started shouting encouragement. Passing several stragglers, Rattan dropped back, came alongside, and delivered a short pep talk as well. We all made it back within the required time, but it was a daunting glimpse of what might lay ahead. I thanked Joe for his help and inquired how he made the run look so easy. It turned out that he'd been active in baseball and athletics at high school and was still a very keen sportsman. A day or so later, Cartwright was sent to the machine gun platoon, while Rattan, Shorty Madonna, and myself were assigned to 1st Squad, 3rd Platoon, Item Company, the very last platoon from 3rd Battalion to be formed. Tocoa would be where Ed learned how to take orders, and in the process, discover he could go much further and do much more than he ever imagined possible. The 506th had originally expected around 2,800 people, but by the time the course began, there were almost 7,000 recruits. The vastly overmanned regiment was divided into 3 battalions. Each had 4 companies, and 3rd battalions were designated HQ, George, Howe, and Item, under overall command of 27-year-old Major Robert Lee Wolverton. At the time, 1st Lieutenant Charles Shettle was in charge of Item, or I Company, with the superb 2nd Lieutenant John Kiley as his executive officer, XO, and cadre man Paul Garrison as 1st Sergeant. Interestingly, Garrison was a local from Tocoa. Their platoon leader was 2nd Lieutenant Fred Anderson from Charlotte, North Carolina. Stocky, round-faced, and just under 6 feet tall, Anderson liked to drink and loved to tease between telling jokes and delivering endless wisecracks. Although he did not suffer fools, Andy was approachable and always on hand to help with any personal issues. He would prove to be an invaluable comrade in arms once the 506th landed in Europe. Forged from steel. Officially activated on July 20, 1942, the 506th Parachute Infantry Regiment was the brainchild of 37-year-old Colonel Robert Frederick Sink. A Southern boy from Lexington, North Carolina, Sink was a graduate of the prestigious West Point Military Academy and had been an early pioneer of parachute tactics and organization. With great energy and determination, Sink, known as the Fox, was about to put into effect one of the most grueling training regimes ever experienced by any World War II American military unit. But along with rigor came fairness and concern. No problem was too small for his attention. He believed in discipline and order, but was not strictly spit and polish. The Fox was also a family man and lived locally with his pregnant wife, Margaret, and their daughters, Margaret, 7, and Mary, 10, playfully known as Flip and Petey. Back in North Carolina, Bob Sink's father, Fred, was active in state politics and ran a local daily newspaper, The Dispatch, which, over the next 3 years, would report every move made by the colonel and the 506th PIR. The basic recruit accommodation at Tocoa, formerly known as Camp Tombs, was constructed around a grid system and comprised 12 neat rows of single-story wooden huts, each row serviced by its own mess hall. Subdivided into 4 distinct blocks, the 3rd Battalion area consisted of approximately 36 tar paper barracks with dedicated latrine and ablutions facilities. Ed, Joe Madonna, and George Rattan were assigned to one of the busy barrack rooms, along with privates Joe Gorance, Jim Jaffet, and Don Ross. After Reveille the following morning, the men formed up outside on the company street for roll call. Everything we did from now on was done at the double, even going to our mess, which incidentally had a slogan pinned to the wall stating, "Take what you want, eat what you take." During the first week, following breakfast, the cadre instructor for Ed's squad, Sergeant Wodowich, took the men for calisthenics, drill, and PT over on the nearby athletics field situated beyond the parade ground in a shallow valley. The vast, sandy, oblong-shaped training area was dotted with a variety of apparatus, including pull-up bars, 40-foot-high scramble net tower, and mock-up aircraft fuselages. Closer to the parade ground, the 506th had built a parachute school, complete with an outdoor exit trainer, flight swings, and a series of 10-foot wooden ramps from which to practice parachute landing falls, PLFs. A wide drainage channel ran along one side of the athletics field. Built into the steep hill adjacent to the creek was a bone-shattering obstacle course, with both the start and finish points straddling the brackish water. Fenced on both sides like a racetrack, Colonel Sink's terrifying folly ran through pine woods up and down the hillside and featured, amongst its many sadistic creations, a 12-foot-high log wall and 20-foot-high jump platform. Like the mountain, we were expected to run the torturous course at least 3 or 4 times a week. In between, we embarked on a series of 20-mile route marches, coupled with fieldcraft lessons and combat training. Hundreds of people washed out during the first few weeks. The cadre closely monitored our performance, and any man who couldn't match up to the stiffening criteria was sent packing. Sink made a bet with one of his old classmates from West Point, who then arrived with a platoon of Marines, intent on showing us civilians how quickly the professionals could lick the assault course. But despite the obvious bravado, they failed to complete, saying certain aspects were just too risky for them to attempt before sheepishly returning to Paris Island to rebuild their wounded pride. I did my best to avoid the more mundane things like kitchen duty or KP, but occasionally got caught for general company duties that the Army called charge of quarters, CQ. During one particular CQ, Lieutenant Shettle instructed me to collect a letter from regimental headquarters, which overlooked the parade ground. As Ed entered the building, he snapped a quick salute at Sink's executive officer, Lieutenant Colonel Charles Chase, who simply nodded and smiled as he passed by. Also point-trained, Charlie was Sink's polar opposite. Steady and cool, Chase was a teetotaler and came from an old established family in New Hampshire. Softly spoken, his speech was measured, unemotional but impeccable, the sign of a true Connecticut Yankee. The envelope had already been opened by Sink, who had written in large letters across the front, "Requires your immediate attention." Being curious, I looked inside and was surprised to read that it was a final demand for payment from a debt collection agency in Baltimore. Upon seeing the open envelope, Shettle, who had a mean streak, became angry. "Did you open this? Did you read this, Shames?" Standing at attention, I denied everything. Nothing more was said, but from that moment, Shettle started to single me out for any trivial misdemeanor or infraction. As the weather began to improve, The large ventilation grill above the front door of Ed's hut proved woefully inadequate against the heat of a late Georgian summer. One particular evening, after a few cups of white lightning, Don Ross picked up a trumpet that belonged to another soldier. Originating from San Francisco, 20-year-old Ross had a talent for the trombone, but more importantly, the bugle, having played both instruments throughout his teenage years. Ed was spellbound by Don's skill, and after several bugle-style renditions, mischievously encouraged his friend to step outside and blow reveille with all the power and finesse he could muster. Although it was well after dark, the entire camp sprang into life as people started forming up on their respective company streets. In fits of laughter, we dashed inside as Sink's voice angrily crackled across the loudspeaker system. "Whoever blew that bugle, I want him found and brought to my office immediately!" Of course, Sink never discovered who it was, and the event was soon forgotten as summer quickly passed into fall. Running in formation, I Company was now completing Currahee in less than 50 minutes. The entire regiment was blossoming into Sink's vision, with every soldier now willing to take on any challenge, firm in the belief that he would overcome it. To show off the regiment's physical prowess, during a Saturday morning visit by the Agricultural Adjustment Administration, AAA program, the Fox ordered his men to wear swimming trunks and jump boots before running the mountain in platoon order. But it was not all toil and sweat. Some, like First Sergeant Garrison, got married with full military tradition. Others went on past to Toccoa and Gainesville, or spent off-duty hours in the roadside diners that dotted the area around the camp. We were getting about 3 weekend passes a month to Atlanta. Jim Jaffet, whose family were wealthy cattle people from Texas, was used to nice things, and always insisted that we stay at the Piedmont Hotel. Of course, this 4-star palace was way above what Madonna and I could afford, but Jim always generously picked up the tab. I mean, we were used to paying just over a dollar for an evening meal from the Wagon Wheel Bar outside of camp, and at that time a steak dinner at the Piedmont cost around $10. As a private, I was earning $50 a month, and after deductions such as laundry, PX, postal exchange, and insurance, took home around $20. Shorty, Madonna, was a habitual gambler, and within 15 minutes of being paid was usually broke, after being fleeced by Baron Duber, our company communications sergeant from Los Angeles. Not surprisingly, he never approached Jim Jaffet for money, but the rest of us were always bailing him out. Subsequently, Madonna and Shames started a shoeshine business. On an average Friday night, the two friends made about $12 each, polishing jump boots for those destined for weekend furlough. Weeks of 12-hour days were spent on dry firing and drills, designed to familiarize the men with their individual weapon, the M1 Garand rifle. Intercompany rivalry was high, and so was the expectation that each platoon would vie to produce the largest number of sharpshooters and marksmen. Only the week before, 1st Battalion had set a stratospheric standard during their skill at arms contest at the nearby Camp Croft range, and 3rd Battalion were not going to be outdone. Major Wolverton promised 3-day passes for every man who scored expert, and then decided that his soldiers would march at least 30 miles with full combat load across the state line into South Carolina to the Reserve Officer Training Corps, ROTC, ranges at Clemson University. 3rd Battalion, less the MG platoon, spent 1 week at Clemson, where some of the previously parachute-qualified officers and NCOs made a display jump in front of the cadets. The week at Clemson was a huge deal for us, and despite achieving expert on the M1, because our overall score was slightly less than 100%, Don, Shorty, and myself were reassigned to crew a 30-caliber machine gun in 3rd Squad. While acting as a spotter for some of the other recruits, Andy Anderson noticed that I was able to pinpoint a strike at 700 yards with the naked eye. As a consequence, he appointed me gunner, Shorty my assistant, and Don our ammo carrier. The return march on Sunday, October 24th, commenced at 1900 hours, took 18 hours to complete, and covered a distance of 49 miles. For the first few miles, everyone chatted and laughed as they marched, but as it got dark and the hours passed, the battalion knuckled down into silence and hunger as the distance gradually began to unravel. Bizarrely, around this time, when he heard we'd nicknamed him the Red Death because of his permanently rosy complexion, Shettle interviewed every man in the company to ascertain why he was so unpopular. When it came to my turn, he chewed me out for not wearing my stripe after being promoted to first gunner on the MG. To be honest, Shettle did a passable job, but it was still a very strange thing for an officer to do. Just to spite him, I never did sew on my stripe, which constantly needled good old Charlie every time he saw me. Throughout October and November, most of the officers and some of the cadre were put through their paces on the mock-up fuselages, 34-foot-high outdoor exit trainer, flight swings, and 10-foot jump platforms. The apparatus had been specifically designed and built to prepare and condition the recruits for the parachute school at Fort Benning. The exit trainer filled everyone with a deep sense of dread. Each candidate was expected to hook the strap of his harness onto a steel zip wire before leaping through the open door and sliding some 250 yards to the ground. Failing to achieve a good push-out meant a straight drop of around 20 feet, whereupon a potential smooth descent would be violently interrupted by the harness pulling tightly around the crotch. By the end of November, the last few officers completed parachute packing and ground training courses and were driven out to a nearby airport maintained by the Le Tourneau Company, who manufactured earth-moving equipment. The first jump onto Dix Hill Drop Zone, DZ, went well, although the other four had to be postponed for a few days due to bad weather. Afterwards, a prop blast party was held in the officers' mess, where each newly qualified parachutist was required to consume a concoction of alcohol from the nose hub of a C-47, while his colleagues shouted, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000. Meanwhile, Ed Shames and the rest of his company were going through an enhanced specialist program that included parachute ground training, courses in signals and demolition, basic hand-to-hand combat, and endless lectures, as well as the usual fitness regime of mountain and obstacle course. During this phase, our barracks were emptying at an alarming rate, as hundreds more dropped out either through injury or lack of moral fiber. Toward the end of our time at Tocoa, those of us who survived uninjured were running certain sections of the obstacle course with full field pack in under 4 minutes. As the first phase drew to a close and the weather started to get colder, we anxiously began looking forward to jump school. But that would quite literally be a walk in the park compared to what was about to happen next. By early December, the regiment received its movement orders for Fort Benning, and in doing so, became the first unit ever to go through the jump school as one complete organization. After Major Billy Turner and 1st Battalion had departed by train, Robert Strayer requested permission from Colonel Sink to march 2nd Battalion, accompanied by half of the regiment's medical detachment, to the railway station in downtown Atlanta. The 2nd Battalion group, numbering 586 men, set off from Tocoa on Tuesday, December 1st, and arrived 3 days later, clocking a marching time of 33 hours and 30 minutes, covering a distance of 118 miles. Not to be outdone by the ROTC-trained Strayer, Point Man Wolverton was given permission to transport 3506 by train to Atlanta, and from there make the journey, estimated to be around 136 miles, to Benning on foot. The idea was to smash the Japanese Army distance marching record, and in doing so, generate extra publicity for the 506th PIR, who were still an independent unit looking for a home. Diminutive and bullish, Wolverton was from Elkins, West Virginia, and had a subtle sense of humor. At times, he could be a man of few words, but when he did talk, whether questioning or responding, it was clear, precise, and very much to the point. Captain Harold Hank Hanna and Regimental Headquarters Company joined 3rd Battalion, along with the rest of the medics, giving a total headcount of just over 700 men. For the majority of the march, the weather was misty, cold, and wet. The battalion group, wearing coveralls and helmets and carrying weapons, full packs, and 3 days' rations, plowed through driving rain, singing cadence songs and popular tunes. Third Squad made a deal to go all the way. Nobody complained, we just got on with it. What we as a battalion were attempting was unprecedented in U.S. military history, and the press, both local and national, took a deep interest. The average rifleman carried around 60 pounds. But for those like myself, Joe, and Don, who were hauling heavier crew-served weapons, plus our M1s, we had to rotate the gun and tripod constantly just to keep up. After stopping for the night, we had a whip round and sent one of the boys across the road to a grocery store for a couple of bottles of cheap whiskey. Gathering around our shelter halves, we toasted each other and then got quietly oiled before hitting the sack. Despite regular 10-minute breaks, the rest of the journey was grueling, and every morning it took a good couple of miles to get going again. Dozens fell out along the way, suffering from blisters, but were quickly patched up by the medics. The battalion spent 4 days on the road with Bob Wolverton leading and setting the pace. Due to badly swollen feet, the major had been forced to remove his boots and continue wearing 3 pairs of socks. It was then that we began to realize just what a truly inspirational leader Wolverton was. I mean, he could have easily got into one of the support wagons, like Captains Graham, G Company, and Stoffregan, HQ Company, but instead, he chose to remain with us. Finally, on the fourth night, after almost 45 hours of marching, the battalion approached Benning. With the red lights of the 3 massive jump towers visible in the distance, Wolverton gave the order to double time. Colonel Sink and the remainder of the regiment, along with Parachute School Commanding Officer Brigadier General George Howell, were waiting at the main gate as Wolverton and his troops hiked past, destroying the Japanese record by an impressive margin. Standing in front of a large welcome sign which read, "Long walkin', loud talkin', non-jumpin' sons of bitches," the band of the 505th PIR knocked out a series of lively tunes for the momentous occasion. From here, we continued for another few miles deeper into the vast camp to our accommodation, designated Outpost Number 1, also known as the Frying Pan Area. After a sumptuous hot meal and gallons of coffee served in our new mess, weary but elated, we gingerly limped off to our beds for a very well-earned night's sleep. The Benning Shuffle. On December 12, 1942, following 2 days' recuperation, Shames and over 500 soldiers from 3506 joined 2nd Battalion, RHQ, the Med Debt and Service Company, and were assigned to Course Number 49. I Company was split up into smaller groups, giving Ed and his team the opportunity to get to know people from the other platoons, such as Privates Lonnie Gavrock from Memphis, Tennessee, Robert Moon, Jack and Jim Brown from Alaska, Bill Galbraith from California, and Joe Byerly. A smart operator, tall and blonde-haired, Byerly was from Michigan and still owed me and Shorty some shoeshine money. Despite all the physical training we'd just been through, Bob Moon had an enormous backside, and because of his surname, consequently took a lot of stick from the rest of us in the syndicate. Lieutenant Kiley was also on Ed's course, having failed to complete at Tocoa after the troop carrier C-47 being used to jump the officers was written off when it overshot the runway. The lean, mean parachute jump instructors were completely unprepared for the level of fitness shown by 1st Battalion during their first week on Benning's specialist pre-para program known as the Fort Benning Shuffle. Subsequently, Course 49 skipped the usual regular Army physical preparation and went straight on to the next phase, which consisted of ground training and landing drills. However, this didn't stop the directing staff, dressed in their distinctive khaki baseball caps and white t-shirts, trying naively to break us down. Eventually, they realized that we could cope with pretty much anything they could throw at us, including countless press-ups, which they stupidly thought to be our weak point. Eventually, the instructors were forced to back off and use more polite verbal forms of encouragement. However, the regiment kept its own physical training program going with regular PT sessions and 9-mile morning runs around the perimeter track of nearby Lawson Army Airfield. By Christmas Eve, after passing all the required training blocks, Ed and his syndicate had reached C stage and were waiting for one particular test out at the enormous jump towers. Each crane, originally built for the New York 1939 World's Fair, was 250 feet high and fitted with 4 arms, each one designated for a different aspect of parachuting, including controlled descents and freefall. Nobody was looking forward to the shock harness. When it came to my turn, I was attached to a long beam and hoisted upwards toward the top of the tower. Suspended in a parachute harness underneath the apparatus, parallel to the ground, my hand was physically shaking as I clutched onto the release handle. When the instructor shouted from below, "Arm number one, ready? Okay, release!" I pulled with all my might and dropped like a stone until the risers arrested my fall. It was a scary experience, but we only got one attempt. Anyone who couldn't do the test was immediately failed. While Ed and his friends were going through C stage, most of the previously parachute-qualified officers and senior NCOs were learning to become jump masters. The 2-week course covered aircraft inspection, inside and out, prior to implaning, plus instruction drills, under-slung loads, equipment checks, and the specific commands necessary for jumping a stick of up to 20 men. Sink's adjutant at the time, Frank Thorpe III, took it upon himself to organize a written test for those of us who, after completing jump school, wished to be considered for OCS. About 60 people were selected, including Rattan, Jaffet, and myself. Despite being somewhat surprised when Colonel Sink walked into our meeting room, we respectfully stood to attention. Screwing his cap around on his head, the colonel finally shaped it into position before speaking. "Thank you all for the gallant interest you have shown in becoming officers. But contrary to what Captain Thorpe might think, I simply cannot allow this to happen. However, at a later date, if in combat you prove worthy, and I know who you are, then it might be possible to award some of you with battlefield commissions. Dismissed. To your duties. Fall out." We were somewhat confused by the ruling, but Sink had his reasons, and his word was law. Before Ed and the other students moved on to parachuting, they spent time in the sweltering packing sheds, learning how to pack the chutes that they were going to use. Lead-filled canvas bags allowed the silk to be held in place, while the canopies were laid out on purpose-built benches. The rigging lines of each parachute were all connected at the top of the 28-foot diameter canopy by what is known as the apex tie. Looped at each end, the 7-inch-long cord is the last physical connection to the aircraft upon exit. Many, like me, had never been in a plane before, and the smell of aviation fuel coupled with the stifling heat was something else, recalled Ed. During our first jump from Lawson Field on New Year's Day, I got a bad exit and injured several ligaments when the static line became wrapped around my leg. Despite the pain, I followed the drills that had been drummed into me. 1,000, 2,000, 3,000. Check canopy. Check oscillation. Get your back into the wind. Check drift. Feet and knees together. Knees slightly bent. Chin on chest and prepare to land. My landing was heavy, and while struggling to unhook my reserve and complete the harness release drills, I realized that this was something that I wasn't going to like. But I'd earned the right, and the anxiety was something that I simply had to get accustomed to. The swelling was so bad that the medics strapped and completely immobilized my knee so I could make the next jump a couple of hours later. The following day, we completed our remaining 3 descents, and straight afterwards, I checked into the base hospital for emergency treatment. Some of the other companies made 5 jumps in 1 day, so you can imagine how exhausting that must have been for them. I was lucky. Bob Moon smashed his ankle so badly on one landing that he was forced to quit the outfit. Uniform pressed, jump boots polished, and pants perfectly pressed and bloused, it was a proud day when we were awarded our wings and given a 2-week furlough. Before the course broke up, Colonel Sink had the last word. "You must keep in mind that not only are you now a member of the Airborne Elite, but that you belong to one of the finest regiments in the U.S. Army. Good luck. Behave yourselves at home, and start looking forward to the tactical phase at Camp McCall." With the exception of First Sergeants Paul Garrison, Jim J.P. Shirley, HQ Company, Gordon Bowles, H Company, and several others like Staff Sergeants Geechee Lindler and John Taormina, 99% of the cadre remained behind at Tocoa to train the 501st PIR, who were already part of the recently formed 101st Airborne Division, 511th and 517th, respectively. Despite being turned down for OCS, Jim Jaffet was promoted to sergeant and assigned to 1st Platoon under 2nd Lieutenant Jerry Howard. Jerry was a gentleman who really seemed to care about his men. Meanwhile, Andy Anderson asked Rattan to take over 3rd Platoon as our platoon sergeant. Seeing Jim and George reassigned was a blow, but I figured my chance would surely come. It was just a matter of time. Walkin' Tall. The regiment returned to Fort Benning and spent the next 2 weeks at their old dilapidated camp in the frying pan area close to Lawson Field. During that time, they were prepared for the Fighting in Built-Up Areas, FIBUA, phase of training, which was to take place across the Chattahoochee River in Alabama. While here in Bama, Shames, who had still not fully recovered from his parachuting injury, Ross and Madonna did their next jump with full equipment on February 19th. After completion, the unit headed by train to the town of Hoffman in North Carolina, 15 miles down the road from Fort Bragg. Being a Southern boy, I loved our new home at Camp McCall, with its purpose-built barracks and wonderful mess halls complete with jukeboxes. Over the next few months, the training intensified, with plenty of 2- and 3-day field problems. One particular Thursday afternoon, we'd just completed a 25-mile battle march in our newly issued jump jackets and pants, and had stopped for the night. The following morning, Lieutenant Anderson asked me and the other gun commanders to deploy in depth and provide a defensive ring around the platoon with our machine guns. Using a borrowed map, I selected a fantastic spot that not only had great cover, but also provided superb arcs of fire. As Don and Joe were digging in to set up the gun, I began creating a detailed overlay complete with military abbreviations and icons showing our company and platoon command posts, CPs, plus pre-recorded targets and their ranges. A few hours later, Anderson and Wolverton arrived to inspect our site. Standing to attention, I saluted and gave Wolverton, who had recently been promoted to lieutenant colonel, my name and rank, and then explained my arcs and why I chose this particular spot. After looking around for a few minutes, the colonel asked, "Who laid this position out?"
"I did, sir."
"You did? You mean by yourself?"
"Yes, sir."
Then, completely against protocol, I seized the opportunity and told him that I could read a map just as well as any officer he had in his battalion. That got his attention. Slightly taken aback, Wolverton responded,
"Go on, then. Explain to me how you planned it."
Using these map overlays, sir."
"Overlays? What overlays?"
After handing over my map case to Wolverton, he inquired how a kid like me knew so much about topography.
"Maps are my hobby, sir, and have been since I was a kid."
At that moment, Wolverton turned toward a rather bemused-looking Anderson.
"Please wait here, Lieutenant, while I go find Charlie Shettle."
Only recently, Wolverton had been captured on a training exercise and tied to a tree by the enemy, who then commandeered his jeep.
The colonel had found the blunder in intelligence deeply embarrassing, and unbeknown to Shames, was now on the lookout for new blood for his planning and operations department, or S3 for short. A few minutes later, Wolverton returned with not only the Red Death, but also the other two platoon leaders, Jerry Howard and Jim Nye. At that point, Madonna, Ross, and myself were pushed to one side, while Wolverton, still holding my map case, discussed the gun position with Shettle and the others. We couldn't believe what happened next. After dismissing all the officers, Wolverton took me aside and inquired,
"Shames, how would you like to be my operations sergeant?"
"Sir, doesn't that require the rank of staff sergeant?"
"Yes, but don't get ahead of yourself here."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.